I pause here and grant you the possibility to have some questions. Okay. You have questions, comments?
I wonder what are the reasons of the poor ratification of the convention, and whether the consequences depend on the official listing of who decides that's a cultural heritage, so it would be a legal consequences for destroying it or not. The military invaders or the actual community.
The poor implementation of international humanitarian law does not really depend in the first step on which convention we are talking about. Yeah? Some conventions are more successful in terms of the quantity of ratifications of signatures of member states, others are less successful. Yeah? The second aspect is how well it is implemented. And this simply depends then on the parliament drafting the implementation law, for example, in regard to the Convention for the Protection of Cultural Property in the Event of Armed Conflict, but also the Illicit Trade Convention. For example, Germany has a very poor implementation law on the Convention of Illicit Trade, yeah? A very poor one. It was passed, I think, not so long ago, 3 years, 4 years ago. Yeah? So the international community has gathered a lot of experience in this respect. Nevertheless, the German Bundestag decided to pass a very good law. Yeah? Depending on internal discussions, yeah? And principles on trade in general. Yeah? And the reasons why the Hague Convention can be implemented in a bad way is also lack of interest, opposition of military, opposition of other political agents, yeah? Or some higher priorities. Yeah? So there is a set of reasons why, when once the convention is signed and ratified by a government, it can be implemented in poor hand. Yeah? And this is true for basically all of the conventions of international humanitarian law. Yeah? And who decides what property to be protected? This is certainly up to the national government. Yeah? Government comes up with this. Yeah? The same is true, for example, of course, for the World Heritage Convention. I mean, it's the country coming up with proposals what to put on the list or not. Yeah? In terms of the World Heritage Convention, then there would be the decision of an international board whether the proposal is accepted or not. In regard to the Hague Convention, UNESCO has no option to deny or refuse the status or the decisions of a national government. Simply up to the national government. What to be protected and what not. The government makes a list and sends the list to UNESCO as the holder, the depositary of the Hague Convention. Yeah? There the data are available. And whether penal consequences are faced or not in terms of destruction, first of all, the affected country has to make a claim. Yeah? UNESCO is not going out and watch over what property is not destroyed. Yeah? But the country affected, for example, when Iraq was invaded by the coalition of the UN, it was up to the government of Iraq to make a claim that property was destroyed. That's the first principle. Yeah? And then there would be, you know, investigations whether the destruction really occurred and whether the destruction was justified according to international law or not justified. Nevertheless, in the framework of the original Hague Convention of 54, there are no real penal consequences. Yeah? The penal consequences come with the second protocol of the Hague Convention of 1999. Yeah? But, and this is very important, yeah, not to know, a country that has signed and ratified the Hague Convention is not necessarily bound to the second protocol. Only when it signed also the second protocol, the regulations of the second protocol are also in force. Yeah? I will show you slides about you know, a list of countries that have signed, about 130 countries that have signed and ratified the Hague Convention, and then the statistics on who then assigned the first proposal, the second proposal, so on.
Syria didn't sign the second protocol. They're working on it now.
The second protocol was for a longer period. The second protocol came into force only 5 years after it was drafted, because in international convention, the European conventions usually have the national tooling base defining the principles when it enters into force. So it needs a number of states as signatories to enter into force. And the second protocol was signed in the Hague 99 by only, I don't know, 4 or 5 countries. It took 5 years to gather a sufficient number of signatures so that they connected the protocol to enter into force. And still today, not so many countries are willing to follow these regulations. Because they also implement penal consequences in terms of violation.
First of all, really thank you. There are many insightful points that I didn't really know about with regards to the armed conflict. I think, and I might be wrong, but there are all these regulations and conventions. However, they are more or less useless in terms of the implementation, because there is sovereignty of the country itself, and usually in armed conflict, as long as the country does not want to recognize that something has been violated and that would be based to certain interests, then that will not really be implied. Also, there are no consequences. You just mentioned how second protocol is not popular due to some kind of consequences if not followed. Also, the thing that is with not using, like, even when some armed forces are kind of facing the penal code, then they find or figure out ways to get out of the loop, like using armed forces that are not military, like they're like paid off again and things like that,
right.
Like private, like in Iraq. Also, when a country is occupying another country, also like in Iraq, many rules have been changed. So they also kind of got out of it. So I would like to know if you think that there is a possibility to kind of top up all of these conventions that are to escape that sovereignty problem that we are facing, and to find something that is more of global. I really do understand that every and each case is unique, but I think that in many cases, like what's going on now in the Arab countries or occupation like in Palestine, these are very hard to implement, and so much is being lost during the process that probably we should think of something different to do. I'm thinking, because I don't know how to reach it, that we really should find a global scheme, something that through we can escape the problem of whether it's bilateral, whether it was signed or ratified, who did it and how did it, claimed or not claimed. I think there should, something should be universal, really universal value that no one can say we don't agree on this.
Consensus.
Yes, universal consensus on a certain cultural heritage value.
There are two things. I mean, laws are always, to put it bluntly, useless when they are not enforced. Also, traffic laws in Berlin or Cottbus are useless when they are not enforced.
Yes.
Yeah? Same is true for international humanitarian law.
Yes.
Yeah? I mean, youth protection laws said alcohol must not be delivered to youth under the age of 18. Yeah? Good law, useless when every 14-year-old gets a drink in a bar at Cottbus. And that's it basically. That's true for every national law, that's true for international law. Yeah? It has to be enforced, otherwise it doesn't come into effect. In terms of evaluation of the effect of, for example, the Convention for the Protection of Cultural Property in the event of armed conflict, people tend to look only at the destruction that occurred. You have a very hard time, you would have a very hard time to evaluate the destruction that did not happen because the Hague Convention was implemented properly and observed by Jews. A similar line of argument, but totally different aspect, because of the terror strike in Paris. We only are aware of the terror strikes that occur. We do not know about the terror strikes that did not occur because they were prevented by security. And when you look, for example, at the case of Iraq 2003 onwards, I mean, we have seen a lot of destruction and misconduct by Iraqi forces, by coalition forces. But when you really look into depth, you will see a series of decisions respecting the principles of the Hague Convention and therefore the protection of heritage. For example, a very prominent situation was the decision by US Air Force not to bomb Iraqi Air Force based at Iraqi Air Force based at Ur. In Ur, there was the famous Ziggurat of Ur, and the Iraqi aircrafts, the MiGs, were parked 100 meters next to the Ziggurat. And we know the decision is also on video and taped. We know the decision that there was a communication between the pilots in the American airplanes back to the base of the targets now in sight. Estimated distance to the tower so and so using the charge in the calendar of the shooting so and so, waiting in order to launch rocket. And the order was denied. With the argument that the Ziggurat would be dead afterwards. And you would be able to make a series of such decisions in the 2003 war and in many other wars. Also in the war of NATO, European NATO, against Libya to change the Gaddafi regime. You know, a series of decisions by target officers to downsize caliber when targeting a Libyan radar or Libyan air defense in regards to respecting cultural heritage in the vicinity of Libyan troops. Of course, what we see is what we register in the media or in update, what we discuss, is the looting and destruction. But especially in the case of Libya and the war against Libya, if you summarize this and evaluate this, there is much more property that is still there and not destroyed by warfare because of decisions respecting cultural property than looting.
So, question. The convention is quite useful, I think. I don't think that's completely not useful, but the thing is with the new era that we live in, with the redistribution of powers in a completely different way, where now, as example, taking Syria as an example, it's not the Syrian army or the Syrian Free Army, it's not an official army or whatsoever called army, is attacking or using the ecological or the cultural heritage properties. It's the chaotic, not central, we don't know even the nature of their, I mean, ISIS or the other military groups that they are dealing with that. Giving example, Palmyra. They entered Palmyra and then they put the bombs around the ruins of Palmyra and then they said, okay, now we wait for the war, we will bomb it if the army will come, we will bomb it if I don't know what. At the end they did. They gave a month of time for the almost for everybody who were watching. But the thing is, not the convention, not the possibility of talking. And at the same time, you cannot apply. You cannot apply the Hague Convention. You cannot apply other convention. You cannot even attack them back because they will bomb it anyway. So in a way, they took it as a hostage for a month. And then, like, we had a big damage in Padia. So I think what you meant also is a concept of consensus that attacking any cultural heritage, tangible, intangible, contemporary, old, is a crime. That whoever made it has to have a consequences, a result of that. He has to face a court or has to face something that is equal to ethnic genocide or is equal to child labor in army, or it's as big as that. That might be, I mean, with the case with ISIS, I don't think anything would scare them, but I mean, for other smaller groups, it might work much more. I mean, since what happened in Syria, I always question all these. I was so proud that we have all these, the humanity came
in. In the first part of your statement, you delivered the response to her question. Yeah? It's a matter of application. Yeah? When and to whom does international law apply? Yeah? When a convention is drafted, it pursues a certain goal. It is meant for somebody on something. Yeah? A convention is meant by basically all other conventions for nation states. Target audience are nation states. Yeah? When actors are not nation states anymore, yeah? International humanitarian law is, so to say, not applied, because it's not meant for it. It does not mean that it's useless, because even if there are other actors that are not addressed by international humanitarian law, or don't feel themselves addressed, it doesn't mean that, so to say, the scope of international law ends. Nevertheless, other forces still are obliged to follow the principles of these conventions. Imagine then, and this is also reality, Russia, who is a party to the convention, starting to intervene. Yeah? Turkey is starting to intervene. The Air Force of Jordan is intervening. The Air Force of Germany will soon start to intervene. Yeah? And then it is decisive whether the target officers of these air forces and the regular air forces are trained on Geneva Convention law, Hague Convention law, and so on and so forth, or not. Yeah? The fact that other militias, ISIS and other forces, are not bound, don't ignore all these rules, is rooted in the fact that they are not addressed by these compound forms.
But that's the point. It's the point that we are facing a huge change in distribution of power. And that's going to happen even more in the future, unfortunately. But that's like a fact. We've heard about this redistribution of power 10 years ago, and we thought that it's like a nice theory. But apparently, now we can see it happening. And I think it's going to happen even further. The challenge, I think, that face the international organizations at this moment is to create a reform somehow of looking at the new trends of everything happening between globalization to the new strengths of countries to the new distribution of power. It has to face and well and meet that. Of course, they were very, very much active with that trends, but at this moment, I think the world is really.
You are totally right.
I'm sorry. See, now.
I mean, the world order is based on the idea of nation states being member of. I don't see that changing so quickly. Maybe the concept of Security Council would change at one point. Just 5 permanent members, maybe that may change in the future. But the world order as such, based on the notion of nation states being joined in the UN, won't change. Nevertheless, there are also other driving forces that change the reality. It's not just the fact that besides regular armed forces and normal militias are fighting in conflicts. We also face the fact that international corporations and mega cities are coming up with higher budgets than nation states. Yeah. Like I would say Apple, Microsoft. of other big corporations and larger margins than, for example, in Chile. And partly also larger deficits than Argentina or Greece. It's not so difficult, because the budget deficit of Greece is not so big. And mega cities, cities with inhabitants from 10 million people up, are already mastering budgets higher than Portugal. This is also reality, but nevertheless, the political world order is still based on the idea of nation states being members of the UN and their drafting corporate of international monetary. And this, I would say, this is an ambivalence. It's out of balance in some way, and it's an ambivalent situation. We hardly deal with the power of megacities and international corporations, and we have no tool dealing with the military power and also the ways of communication and the impact of international organizations, let's put it that way, international organizations like Al Qaeda, Daesh, whatever.
I think we cannot expect these international organizations or UNESCO or some organizations like this to prevent these conflicts, as you said, in the first place. And I think it is not totally useless because, as you said, we cannot prevent, we cannot give a definite solution, but we can mitigate. And I think they have been successful in mitigating the impacts of these conflicts. At least we are now somewhat sure that when we are dealing with these nation states, we can be sure that they take into consideration these conventions. So it can mitigate the effects here.
You're taking up the first slide. You know, ask about conflict solving strategies, conflict preventing strategies. The convention is about mitigation, not solution or prevention of mitigation.
Although I would argue something that I've worked in Syria. I have an example where working with the locals on cultural based community development, where they understand and evaluate the value of the culture that they are neighboring. That although the site is in northeast Syria, it's a mix of Kurd Arab, which makes it very, very high risk of conflict, and it's very much close to the ISIS area now in Syria. It is the only site till now very much protected. Till now, the locals are still protecting the site, cleaning the site, drawing the things, sending us emails about everything they are doing as if there is nothing happening in Syria. And that's also brought them together working Arab and Kurds. And if we think of the Arabs in this area, the majority of their families in other places, because these Arabs have been resettled from another area during the building of the dam. So their relatives are already ISIS or under ISIS, but these Arabs who are living amongst that area are completely cooperative with the Kurds together in protecting the area and still managing the area. So apparently working, not maybe protecting cultural heritage, we were doing that of course, and working cultural heritage, but working with the community in an integral policy somehow, bottom-up approach, helped at least that ecological side till now to stay in a perfect situation, so never attacked by locals. So sometimes working with cultural heritage protection from the very beginning in a specific way might prevent, unless there's a huge power in this case, but might prevent them to attack it. It's the opposite, as example, in the dead cities. The local community has a kind of a distance relation, and they have it's different. The culture of the dead cities is completely different from the culture now of the people living there, the locals there. The first thing that happened, that locals attacked the dead city. The dead cities also are in the Zawiya mountain, which is really very risky and difficult area, which is not less risky than that one, but apparently it has been attacked, and the other one not. And that also has to do with kind of what policies has been done, what kind of strategies has been implemented in that area before, at the time of the normal life, so without or without.
I'm sorry to interfere. This is just a reminder, we have half an hour left.
Can I give you some questions? Thank you very much for your presentation, because it's like it was really impressive that you located the Hague Convention in the line of the military service and the other things. So it's really impressive. And then my question is that I fully agreed with your comments that the protection of the cultural property has to be fulfilled in times of peace. And then you mentioned three different layers of the time: pre-conflict, conflict, and post-conflict era. I'm just wondering whether you have another suggestion how we have a different like a preparation for the different stage, according to the different stage in terms of the protection of culture.
Our academic community.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, it's like how can we prepare for the different stage? Mm-hmm. And then we should, because it's like if the war occurred, and then we are just like a bit worried about the cultural property, but how can you prepare for the pre-post-conflict and post-conflict era? And my second question is that relating to the like power distribution according to the cultural property protection, I just want to ask, I want to give you some comments that who made the convention? So it's like, I'm just wondering whether the convention can be equally applied to the whole, past war. It's a war, the convention is made for the powerful countries, or they really concerned about the countries which lose the, their power. So I just want to ask about your...
The convention was not dictated, and there's a quite interesting material that I would recommend to you. UNESCO published the protocols of the diplomatic conference of the Hague, with all the comments of the different delegations. I don't have the exact title of this material now in my mind, but it's a book like this thing. And there is a discussion for each article back and forth, and also the different versions of the convention that were negotiated over the years, and what was dropped and then later included, and how ongoing conflicts influenced the discussion of the... there was finally a 4 weeks conference in the Hague, but there were many diplomatic meetings before that, right, the early 1950s. And all these discussions were protocoled and are now available. And I think if you ask the NASA, you get free copies, they don't say it.
They also have online on the website itself some of this, when there is like who ratified and what ratified on and stuff like that.
The full protocol. And there you see how, so to say, smaller countries fight for their paragraphs against UK and US, and they should be implemented on the outside. It's a very interesting, has been a very interesting process. It's historically very interesting. And in fact, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict heavily affected the position of Jordan and Lebanon as main actors in the discussion about Article 5 occupation, in opposition to whom to Great Britain, one would not expect. But nevertheless, against the backdrop of British history, occupying half of the world, understand that British military leaders would like to see as little revelations of recognition as possible. But these are very interesting discussions.
So it's a protocol diplomatic.
the protocols of the diplomatic conference, of the Hague conference, was April 21st to May. It is edited by Yemi Toman, T-O-M-A-N. That's the editor. And he also edited recently the protocols of the second conference that led to the second protocol. Both protocols are fully edited and very interesting. And the first question was
pre-conflict and how can we prepare?
Yeah, and this relates, for example, to your question about poor implementation. Global solutions and the most important thing is that in each single country, international conventions are implemented properly, best practice. And therefore, you need a process where you get involved, the civil society gets involved in the political discussion. This is something very important, something you can do. Whether you organize yourself in a new community, new NGO, or whether you participate in the conduct of ICOMOS or ICOM, national communities, you address members of the parliament whom you are responsible for a certain time period on the executive board of drafting an implementation law. This is definitely something that you can do. My organization, unlike ICOMOS, Bushit is, for example, definitely looking at the ways of implementation of the Hague Convention in armed forces, and consequently evaluating this and sending that evaluation sheets to UNESCO at the same time to the ministers of defense. Saying, we have watched this exercise, this is good, this is bad. We have some officers in our ranks who are constantly traveling throughout the world, cut out for our residents currently in Cambodia, watching an exercise of the Cambodian armed forces. And before we went together to Beirut, he was in the Ukraine, where there was no exercise, of course, as we know, but really conflict. But he was watching the conduct of the different armed forces in regard to the observance of international humanitarian law. This is something that you will, of course, not do, at least not tomorrow, but we will be trained for this.
In the same topic, I have a very naive question. You showed us before a slide about why the convention is relevant for the military, and you gave us like some arguments you were presenting to a kind of educational to military or something like that. I have a very nice question because I saw that the discourse you are offering to leaders or giving is I don't know how to explain it. We can feel that you are also using military words and to say okay, be careful, a building can become a bomb or property or something like this. My question is it so complicated to talk about human values to militaries, or do you really need to have this kind of discourse strategy to enter in the way of talking so they can understand what you mean, or is it not possible to talk about how culture and heritage can just be?
This is crucial. Our language is crucial.
Yes.
Otherwise, you communicate and you don't understand each other, and even more dangerous, you misunderstand each other. And the groups in society have different mindsets. Police has a mindset, military has a mindset, students have a mindset, workers have a mindset. And on several issues, you need certain lines of arguments with special terms that fit in the mindset, otherwise your main argument would not arrive.